December 16, 2008, with Town of Benjamin Dumont. Can we have the flag salute and the moment of silence for the start?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, everyone. Sue, could you read the sunshine law, please?
The notice requirements of the Open Public Meetings Act of the state of New Jersey have been satisfied by the inclusion of the date, time, and place of this regular meeting in the annual schedule and notice of regular meetings of this governing body. The annual schedule and notice of regular meetings is posted in Borough Hall, within the record, and in the media, posted on the Borough website, and filed with the Borough of Dumont on January 3, 2008. Councilmembers Castro?
Here.
Lana?
Here.
McQuaid?
Here.
Conway?
Here.
Juliana?
Here.
Dumbchansky?
Here.
Mayor McHale.
Motion to accept the agenda as presented?
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
We also approve the minutes. I have a motion to approve November 25, 2008, executive meeting minutes. Approval?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Roll call vote.
Councilmembers Castro?
Yes.
Lana?
Yes.
McCallum?
Yes.
Juliana?
Yes.
Dumbchansky?
Yes.
McQuaid?
Yes.
Motion to approve November 25, 2008, public meeting minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Councilmembers Castro?
Yes.
Lana?
Yes.
McCallum?
Yes.
Juliana?
Yes.
Dumbchansky?
Yes.
McQuaid?
Yes.
Motion to approve December 2, 2008, executive session minutes.
So moved.
Second. Roll call vote.
Councilmembers Castro?
Yes.
Lana?
Yes.
McCallum?
Yes.
Juliana?
Yes.
Dumbchansky?
Yes.
McQuaid?
Yes.
Thanks for that part. Before we get into committee reports, we do have a little presentation that back on our fire department representatives that we'd like to present to us and to the members of the borough. So, Pat, if you'd like to come up and just present the applicants.
Patrick Connor, 19 Metro Road, Dumont, member of Dumont Fire Department. In July, the fire department received an application through the mayor council from the 200 Club, and usually the fire departments and police department and most folks look at them and do what I've done in the past. But, what are we going to do with this? We never see anything. But this year was a little different. This year we decided to fill it out. We took the attitude that it was a 42-cent stamp grant process. So we did it. We filled out the paperwork and sent the paperwork into the 200 Club. And there was some strict guidelines that the paperwork couldn't be stapled, yet they stapled it when they sent it to me. So we had to make sure that you put the staples out, obviously the attorney to follow instructions. They wanted three price quotes, which I couldn't get them because the item that we were looking for was dealer specific for, as a dealer who could only service at this area. So I kind of violated their request by only giving them one price quote. But again, two price quotes on the same piece. Optics were either a demo piece or a brand new piece that was never in service. Demo giving us a salesman's piece of equipment that was used by a salesman and would be recased and totally warranted just like a brand new camera. The savings on that would be $1,300 and change. So I opted to give them the choice of what they would like to do. October 31st, actually September 1st was the deadline for the application. I got it in somewhere around September 29th, September 28th, somewhere there. October 31st was the grant deadline. October 31st came and went. November came and went. Somewhere around December 1st, I said, I guess we didn't hear anything. Maybe we should get rid of the paperwork. And December 5th, I got a letter that I'd like to share with you. I know Mr. Perkins has a copy of this already. letter reads, "Dear Mr. Connor, this letter is to inform you that the Appropriation Committee has reviewed the request for funding a thermal imager. I'm pleased to advise you that the committee has approved $5,300 as a matching grant for the purchase of this equipment. The 200 Club understands that this matching grant appropriation represents only a portion of the total cost of the equipment your unit wishes to purchase. The unit must contact the club to advise them that you raise the other one, the money. Otherwise, the acquired thing would be defunct. Obviously, we have until June of 2009 to do this. And it's signed by Mr. Jack Turgeon, the president of 200 Club. So, what I'm here tonight is to basically thank you all for your support, because, I mean, some people, myself, can't believe how fast this occurred. I appreciate everything that you have done for us. I know you appreciate what you do for all of you as citizens of the town. So, on behalf of the chiefs who are not here tonight, unfortunately, the members of the Independent Host Company, who are going to be the members who are going to be utilizing this camera, and the members of the fire department, I would like to thank each and every one of you, as well as the citizens of the borough of Dumont, for your support. And I just printed this up tonight so that you guys can see what it is, as far as what the camera is. It's a thermal imager. It'll have two batteries, a truck mounted charger, and a handle for the guys to hold on to and hold on to break it, obviously. And we got $5,300 from the 200 Club. The town has come up with $5,361. So I appreciate all your support and your help.
Yeah.
the leaf pickups went rapidly through this year. The last week for the leaf pickup will be week ending the zoning board. They had a meeting yesterday, and the formal hearing for the 0807 existing capacity, which is the apartment with apartments, was postponed to January meeting. They also the dates for next year's meetings will be on Monday, second Monday of the month, and starts at 7:30. Thank you. Councilor Bennett?
Yes, Mr. President. Thank you. Shade Tree Commission. The Shade Tree Commission is always in need of volunteers. If anyone is willing to give their time, they would be certainly glad to have you part of their team. The commission applied for a community stewardship incentive program grant. That grant is for trees that are to be planted as replacement trees, and also the start of the auditorium. This grant also requires a certified tree expert, which had interviewed with the commission. The all-day celebration is scheduled for April 25th, 2009, between times of 1 p.m. and 3 p.m. Wire report. PKM's report on the condition of the air quality in the North Purpose Room has come back. We are looking at what can be done in-house and which items will be needed to be remediated by experts. The director is reviewing the number of firms that could be used for remediation. The director is also waiting for response from the architect for next steps for the open grants and the historical grant money that we received. And as soon as the architect gets back to next steps, we're going to be presenting the next phase of the program to restore the historical portion of the library building. Buildings and grounds, Mr. Bowen has completed winterization of the tall buildings. And I also thank Bill for his help in planning the Memorial Park and holiday celebration. And that's my report, Mr. President.
Thank you. Mr. Stiliano.
Thank you, Council President. My school board report, the school board is continuing its re-registration process with mixed results. Apparently many families have yet to re-register and established residency, and I guess that leaves them in a little bit of a quandary. They're scrambling to get it done. The next school board meeting is this Thursday night at 7:30 p.m. My police department report, the department received and handled a total of 5,634 calls. Of those, there were 79 requests for medical aid. There were 28 motor vehicle accidents, 20 of which were serious. And Officer John DiGirolamo continues to instruct DARE and BRAKE programs in addition to second grade adopted cop program. And he also was involved with the sponsoring of an event held at Boulder City in Hackensack, which from what I understand was very well attended. And that's my report.
Thank you. Councilman
Cash,
any
report,
sir?
Yes, I do, Bob.
Thank you.
Well, the microphone, you I would like to thank the Commission, the Recreation Commission, for the opportunity to serve them for the past 2 years as a commission, liaison commission. There was a presentation done by Alamo Engineering to the Mayor and Council on December 2nd, the renovation project in Memorial Park Field, Columbia Field, and Columbia Field. There was also a meeting with Mr. Perkins and myself regarding lightning detectors in all the parks in the town. There was a free throw contest run by the Elks on December 15th, the national winner of this contest required Basketball Hall of Fame in Springfield, Massachusetts. Roller hockey opened on Saturday, December 4th, 3 games, and Sunday, December 5th, with 3 games. Girls softball had a pitching clinic being held on Saturday, December 20th at Lincoln School, 9 to noon. Duma residents aged 8 to 14. Instructor is Jim McDonald, softball coach at St. Mary's High School in Rutherford. The fee is $15. Registration is done by Jamie O'Neill. wrestling practice started on December 2nd, and that's my report.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilwoman Zoshan.
Thank you. The senior citizens had their holiday party season. They had about 100 people in attendance, and I heard everyone had a wonderful time. Unfortunately, I couldn't attend it the day of the celebration. They have a New Year's Eve party that will be in the senior center. They have a Super Bowl party February 1st, a meet and greet on February 8th, and today they put together stockings. The director down at South Park collected money from seniors, and they put together stockings that will be sent to Dumont residents who are serving in Iraq. The ambulance corps has 79 April for November, total of 1,068 for the year. I'll ask you guys to attend the board of directors meeting, and as always, they're still looking for volunteers. Fire department had 24 calls in November, total of 371 for the year, 796 man hours for November, total of 10,466 for the year. The fire department held their election Saturday night, and Jim Molnaro was the chief again. Assistant Chief Glenn Berg and Deputy Chief Bill Listamore, I would like to congratulate them all, and I know they'll do a wonderful job. This Friday night, starting at 7 o'clock, Company 2, which is on Prospect Avenue, will be having Santa, and they'll be collecting toys to top, and they'll be moved by. And the winter celebration at Memorial Park, I think, was a wonderful night. There was probably about 3,000 people in attendance, and I'd like to thank the police, DPW, fire, ambulance, all the participants for all their help. And that's our report.
And the other half of the report on the finance side is tonight we're going to be doing the resolution to finalize the transfers of the tubes and drums that we need just to close up the year, and also and for the health department there are still some vaccines left if you want to get a flu shot. You just got to call the health department. There's still plenty of flu vaccine left for people. They didn't have as many as they had last year. If you do need flu shot, you want to come up to school health department, you can help again. And, you know, I think your health insurance will reimburse you for that problem. So, that's it for that. And other than that, let's see. Mr. Perkins, do you have a report?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. A couple things. First of all, to everybody here, families, I hope you have a nice holiday season. Ellen and her committee, I'd like to congratulate you on the Winter Festival. It was definitely very crowded last year. It seems that this will be getting bigger every year, and only good comments came from it, so I congratulate you. As well as thank the DPW Police Department and the Fire Department for the work that they did, especially the DPW for setting up the tearing down that night. It was excellent. I'd also like to congratulate the new chiefs in the fire department too, and wish them safe for the next year. A couple things. The house at Washington and Virginia will be coming down soon. The asbestos removal is scheduled for December 23rd by a certified company, and hopefully in the month of January the house will be taken down and that corner will be smoothed out. We are looking into possibly offering an insurance plan, not through the borough, but through a company called AmeriPlan for those residents who are having a difficult time with insurance coverage. I had a meeting with this company today. There was a cost involved, but there are heavy discounts for going to doctors, prescriptions, dental, and also visual. AmeriPlan has been given documents to look at for the next couple of weeks, and hopefully if it's approved, we will offer this room to the company to have the citizens come in and learn more about it. If they want to get involved, they can. So that's something that we may be looking for in the future. The NJDIT project, which is part of the Dakota flooding problem, the first phase is just about cleaned up. At this point, we have made applications to the state for the second phase to handle some flooding issues around March, and that section of town. We are waiting for the state to authorize it, the application review, to authorize it to down make our pitch for the phase two project, and we're hoping that's going to happen within the next few months. This evening, I received a phone call from the county. We had gone after the county for money for work during the phase one project down around the Milford, which is a county road that we needed to get done in order to assist us on some of the other streets that we've had flooding issues. We were notified today that a check in the amount of $391,000 will be coming to us as soon as I sign the voucher, which I'll sign the first thing tomorrow morning. We were notified by the joint insurance fund that our deductible, our standard deductible for liability in the borough has dropped from $50,000 to $10,000, which is huge. That's per occurrence. One of the reasons that we're up to $50,000 is because I did some old claims that they decided to keep on the books for a number of years, and after three or four meetings with the joint insurance fund people at PERMA, and pleading the case, they notified me by writing that they would reduce it to $10,000. So I want to thank PERMA for that. And we did make application to the Department of Transportation for consideration for improvements to McKinley from Johnson to Prospect, and we were notified within the last few days that application has been denied because of lack of funds by the state.
Okay, and we'll start with the consent or agenda items. Sue, would you read the review of the consent agenda, please?
All items with an asterisk are considered to be non-controversial by the council to be approved by one motion. There may be further discussion prior to the vote upon request of a member of the public or council member. Also, any item may be removed for further discussion of the local vote, in which case the item will be removed and considered in its normal sequence as part of the general order.
Can you please call 325?
That's what I was going to call that. So let me call 0825 and build this right now. Is there anybody else wants to pull any of the resolution?
Second.
Okay. 0821, Fania Richerich hires a permanent subject to crossing guard. 08322, Sean Coyle, approved as member of the fire department. 08323, Christopher T. Dombisky, approval of a member of the fire department. 08324, Terrence B. Walter, approval as member of fire department auxiliary. 08326, Chapter 159, Fire Department Thermal Imager, which is what Ms. Todd has talked to us about tonight about. 08327, approval of Celsus School PTO Love Premise 5050 Camp Raffle on March 14, 2009, RL 287, ID 409537089. 08328, Chapter 159 is obey the sign, pay the fine. That's a $4,000 amount that we've got from the state and for doing that, and it has to go into our general budget, so that's why I have to do that tonight. 08329, authorization of transfer between budget appropriations. 08330, approval of change order number 2 for the NJEIT flood control project. 08331, authorization of T&M Associates to approve plan, specifications and designs for the EIT program, phase two improvements. We have a motion to adopt the consent agenda. So moved.
Second.
Any discussion
from council?
We have a motion to open up to the public on just the consent agenda items only.
So moved.
Second. Okay, well now we'll put up to anybody from the public have anything about what's on the consent agenda right now? Seeing and hearing nobody, do I have a motion to close?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Roll call.
Councilmember Casper?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
McKelvey?
Yes.
Juliana?
Do the motion adopted?
So moved.
Second. Council, any questions? So moved. Super, you want to? Shall we open the public? Anybody in the public? Bill List? Yes.
I can hardly hear you.
I'm sorry.
I can hardly hear you. Is any motion coming up about the shared services?
As far as what shared services is that?
Would it be DPWs?
That would be, you can bring it up in a public session. When you come up, you can come up and talk about whatever you want to after we're done with the, with just this part of consent agenda.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
And you come up to talk whatever you want. Okay.
You probably get me out.
No. Say, hearing nobody? Okay. So roll 320 for the so roll call vote, Sue? For the Bill List?
Councilmember Casper?
Stand.
Mann?
Yes.
McKelvin?
Yes.
Juliana?
Yes.
Kropaski?
Upstand.
McQuaid?
Upstand. Just heard two ordinances. Alright, you're going to be second reading of our ordinances. Ordinance 1372 is amending Chapter 12A, Article 1, repealing Article 12A, Chapter 2B of the Code of Borough Dumont, establishing a joint land use board. That was what was on the referendum that we voted on. Instead of planning and zoning board, two separate boards, we now have one planning and zoning board. So this is the second reading. We have a motion to waive the formal reading.
So moved.
Second. Any discussion from the council? We have a motion open to the public on this.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anybody from the public want to discuss anything to do with this ordinance at the moment? Seeing and hearing nobody? Do a motion to close.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Roll call vote, please.
Councilmember Casper?
Yes.
Mann?
Yes.
McKelvin?
Yes.
Juliana?
Yes.
Kropaski?
Yes.
McQuaid?
Yes. Ordinance 1373, authorization and sale of borough-owned real property known as Block 707, Lot 7 on the tax map, the Borough of Dumont, more commonly known as 66 Lincoln Avenue. Motion to waive the formal reading.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Discussion from the council? Motion open to the public.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Now open to the public on this. We have a piece of property, a small piece of property, again, 66 Lincoln, that we're selling to the owner of the property next door. Does anybody have anything?
Is that where that park is?
It's where the park is, but all the way at the end of the block, on a dead end street.
Okay.
You wouldn't see this piece of property if it fell out. You couldn't find it. It's in the middle of nowhere. It's great.
I can find it.
No, it's good that it's nice that this owner wants to buy it. It's like a useless piece of property if he wants it to buy it. You know? This way the borough doesn't have to cut the lawn anymore. Let that cut it out. And I think he's given us $33,000 for it, so we'll take it every day of the week, anytime we can. But seeing and hearing nobody, can we close? Motion to close?
So
second. All in favor?
Aye.
Do we have a roll call? Motion to adopt.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Roll call vote, please.
Councilmember Casper?
Yes.
Mann?
Yes.
McKelvin?
Yes.
Juliana?
Yes.
Kropaski?
Yes.
McQuaid?
Yes. Thank you. Yes, good motion. At this time, we'll open to the public for any questions you might have, any concerns, anything you'd like to bring up to the mayor and council at this time. Just come on up. Just state your name and your address for the record. That's all we ask.
James Hughes?
No.
Come on up. So we can get you out of the chute.
James Hughes, 1533 West Madison Avenue, Vermont. All right, one, I'd like to express my appreciation for the DPW. They do a wonderful job in this town. And I can't see having shared services with any other town because we have a lot of new equipment. And Warren Dells still has to pick up LEDs, Bernie still hasn't picked up LEDs, Milton still hasn't picked up LEDs. Our superintendent, Billy, I think he's superintendent, he's done a wonderful job. And as far as shared services go, it's like sharing your life. I'm serious. It don't work. You got a town like Oldsworth. They don't do nothing to nobody. They believe that mutual aid was made for them. I'm serious. They got very few police, very few people in their road department. And if CF services does go in, do our employees go to the equipment, or is the equipment going to whoever's sharing?
To be honest with you, well, when you come to shared services, I don't think we would do a lot of what you call shared. There might be some specialties where maybe a sewer truck that might have to go into a sewer and a jet pack or a chipper, if you send a chipper and a tree truck. I don't think our garbage men would ever go there or we would send, no, we have a sewer truck there.
We have a sewer truck, we don't have garbage. We don't have garbage.
No, we have garbage trucks.
But I know, that's the leads and
right.
Other stuff, yeah.
But when it comes to shared services, I think it's some specialty things that the towns, if you go and buy, like you say, a sewer back truck, that costs you hundreds of thousands of dollars that you may only use once in a while. So that's where your shared services come in, where you would borrow from other towns and you would go, and you might go with your crew to do it, and they would pay for it. We would have, if we were to send a crew for our truck, that town's going to pay for the man hours and the truck. We're not going to pay them while they're over doing something in another town.
Okay.
No, but there are times, but there are times when we would specialize in certain things that other towns don't have. Maybe Paul can help me because he's involved in shared services.
One of the things that has to happen first is that there has to be an agreement between the two towns. And if there isn't that mutual agreement of what the service is, how it's going to be paid for, how the equipment is going to be paid for, how it's going to be paid, how we share the cost of what it is, it doesn't matter. Case in point, we were talking for the last 3.5 years of Burbanville and sharing the salt ship. We were still salt for both Burbanville and Dumont, right out of orbit. And to fall apart because Burbanville never came to closure on working with us and sharing the expense of the one to feed, but having the architects going there, engineering, and the actual cost of putting the shed. So we moved ahead with our own shed, this whole shed, because we run the same mandate that every other town in the state is to have salt protected and not left out of the water. So it didn't work for us, and we didn't do it.
No, good.
So, it's on a case-by-case basis, and it has to work for both towns. It's not going to be on the one side of the deal where we're going to lose the deal, but we're just going to do it.
Okay, so it's not going to be a mutual agreement between the staffs.
It has to be something that both towns have agreed on, and it has to be very specific in nature and how it's going to evolve between the menu of the equipment and the service itself. So at this point, we talked about and going to the county about having our leaves taken care of. Because one of our larger costs is getting our leaves.
Right.
It's one time issue, tipping fees and gas fuel surcharges and that kind of stuff. A lot of our government. I think you can come to some sort of county or other towns or business. That's something that we're looking to do, to share that service.
Why can't you share anything with Bergen Jail except mutual aid?
Well, they try.
They stopped picking a garbage up on Washington Avenue, 7 o'clock in the morning. That's ridiculous. You got traffic backed up all over the place. But when you, I've been a truck driver all my life, right? Somebody else uses your truck, they don't come back the same way.
Oh, no, absolutely. That's what the council president said, that we send the crew to the truck so that we all will be handling all the stuff.
Our people will be working the equipment. Okay, that's good, I mean. And one more thing. The social services lady, whatever. Now, you make a donation, does it stay in Dumont? Are you shaking your head?
Yes, it does.
You're asking positive.
Yes.
Now, our CFO is here. Our CFO is also here to elaborate on that also, but it does.
Yes, everything goes to Dumont residents, for me.
But, yeah, hopefully. All right, that's it.
Thank you.
Yes, we got a great meeting.
You do, yes you do. Anybody else? Yes.
Hey, I'm getting called. Anyway, my name is Tom Massey, I'm at 16B American Legion Terrace, Dumont. And I wanted to say hello to Councilman McCallum. You'll get to know me, I'm the person who has some issues with the Elks Club and the neighbors over there on American Legion Terrace. Well, I would be remiss in my duties as a member of the human race if I wanted to come before you tonight and tell you about what an improvement we're having in our situation over there on American Legion Terrace. We're happy to say that the situation in the last, I don't want to quantify the time, but let's call it more than 6 months, there's been a marked improvement in behaviors and so on over there. Now, I attribute this to a number of reasons. One key reason was the participation of Mr. Perkins in negotiations and discussions we had over there, and the rest of the council members and so on, giving their help and support there, and also a change in management over there. There's new management over there. And I think that they are just making the efforts that we always ask them to make. There's certainly been minor things since then, but as we've always maintained, I kind of like the little activity there. It was the howling in the middle of the night and the drunkenness, that was the problem, okay? And they've eliminated that. And I don't want to close the deal yet, I'm honestly optimistic, okay? And we wanted to thank you all for your participation. We're happy that I speak for some of the neighbors over there, and we've been wanting to get here and say that, you know? So it's an act of news. They're really doing a better job there. I guess the word will filter back to them as we talk to Pete Betcher and his mother-in-law and so forth, their neighbors and their friends and everything. I think we're all seeing each other as human beings and, that our interests are common, you know? It was a wrap. You know, you guys have been folks know what's going on there. I mean, there was, you know. And the normal functions there are kind of halfway a little interesting, so make for this fun. Thanks again. Happy holidays to everybody. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Anybody else in public or agency?
First, I'd like to thank the
Mr. Chair, I couldn't hear you.
Sorry, what?
Green Initiative, the...
Green Initiative, okay.
The press release on October.
Frankly, with all due respect, I'm a little confused as to this press release.
Mr. Chair, can you hold the mic a little bit?
Sure. Now, when you say you're recycling 51% of alternative fuel, does that mean you're blending in 51% of oil in the diesel?
Yes, vegetable.
So you're basically mixing the vegetable oil with the diesel half and half?
Yes.
Okay. I know you said that you're not an engineer, but this is a fairly well-documented subject. U.S. Department of Energy has a biodiesel handling and use guidelines. Okay. Right on the first pages, it says here, raw or refined vegetable oil will recycle leases that have not been processed into biodiesel or are not biodiesel and should be avoided. In fact, they're very clear in saying, research shows that vegetable oil leases used in diesel engines at level as low as 10-20% can cause long-term engine positive from sticking, oil jumping, and other maintenance problems that can reduce engine life. You want to blend the oil with diesel 50-50, you can't kill the engine.
That's Mr. Chen. Who wrote that?
It's issued by the U.S. Department of Energy, Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy. It's a DOE document, third edition, September 2006. I can make this available for the
I've always looked at when somebody writes something, mm-hmm. there's always one side and there's always the second side.
Sure.
They always have to look at who's writing it, why they're writing it, and what they're staking at. That's something they're looking at. I could probably bring you something tomorrow that says that blending oil is probably the greatest thing that ever happened since sliced bread. And
sure.
Who knows if it's the right thing or the wrong? We
sure.
go along back and forth.
Sure, but this is issued by the U.S. government.
No. Just one little clarification.
Yeah.
Not that matter that much, just for the record. 49% to 51%. It's not
50-50. Okay, that's fine. But it says very clear here that as low as 10-20% will cause problems.
That's why we established this pilot. We instituted as the norm to see if in fact using this vegetable oil as a mix would A, reduce the force of our fuel pools, and whether or not we would have a beneficial effect on the environment.
Right.
We consulted with the Westwood, who's been in this pilot for 6 months, 7 months. And they've been running their vehicles with no problems. So that's why we looked at our project and look at establishing a pilot here and see if in fact we can do the same thing. The vegetable oil that we're using is being filtered in the centrifuge. So the result that we've gotten thus far out of 100 gallons of oil, within 75 gallons of process, the trucks are not running as well. And we save a substantial amount of money per gallon per diesel. So I don't believe that since the diesel was designed and invented to burn soy oil, that using processed fish oil would be a detriment to the trucks.
Right. With all due respect, I have the prices here for biodiesel going back to February 2008, the last quote I got from November 19th, it says for ultra slow sulfur diesel is $1.90. I'm not sure how much more money you can save by putting in vegetable oil. But again, my question goes back to this document, which very clearly says that you're not going to see any immediate issue.
Well, I'd
sure.
like to talk with the DPW and the other administrator at Westwood to see if in fact they have the same issue or not. You know, this is not a new process.
It's not.
Process, no, it's not a process. No. It's used all across the country. And that's why I'm a little perplexed that the federal government would put out an argument saying that it's not really considered good.
In fact, the state of New Jersey has contract fuel and gas prices. They have B5, which is biodiesel 5%, B10, biodiesel 10%, and B20, biodiesel 20%. So that's the highest they offer. They don't offer anything higher than that, I think. It's, now, through this option, the reasons are fairly obvious.
If I may, Carl. First of all, the 51% is a high end number. As the councilman mentioned, this is definitely a pilot program. This is something where our first line every single morning is what with, oil across the run. We talk a lot to Westwood, we talk a lot to Oradell, who's also in the process of doing this. We don't maintain that we're getting, a couple hundred gallons a week. The gelling issue that you spoke about earlier is something that comes as a result of climate. We have stopped utilizing the oil at this point because of the temperature. And everybody knows if you take your oil and you stick it in your refrigerator, it gets kind of stiff. And we're not looking to do that. So we've suspended operation, although we're still getting the oil and cleaning it and storing it. We're not utilizing it now. The number of 51% is a high number. I can tell you that I have spoken to people who have used almost 100% in diesel, and it works absolutely fine.
Yes.
Now, long term, I don't know what the long term ramifications are. Westwood has been checking, as have we, to make sure that they're not getting clogged, because if you're only spending 53 cents a gallon to put in biofuel into our trucks, and we're spending $8 a week or $10 a week for a filter, your cost is getting a little bit closer. But we haven't seen that right now. Again, this isn't rocket science. It's either going to work or it's not going to work. But the people that we've talked to says it works. I would love to see Cotton's report, if you can make that available to us. And we will definitely, peruse that and see what it says. And if it maintains that we should be making corrective changes, we'll make corrective changes. The last thing I want to do is see that we have to, change a diesel engine. But I can tell you we've used it for at least half the summer. It worked extremely well. The only problem was the guys on some of the back of the trucks were getting hungry because they were smelling, french fries or whatever coming out of the exhaust. And that's but if you could make a copy of that available,
we'd
appreciate that.
Sure. So let me make this clear. You're saying now that the biodiesel program has been suspended until spring? Or?
Yeah, there, I can tell you that there is an additive that Westwood attempted to use where the oil would not solidify. And that's something that we were interested in. We didn't try it. They tried it. The additive did not work. And my understanding is, unless they come up with something in the last week and a half or 2 weeks, they've also suspended their operation in utilizing the biofuel too.
Okay. All right. So now it's just being stored.
Yes.
Do you also understand that biofuels, anything that's bio-related, is life supporting and does not last forever? After a few weeks of storage, it will go bad, just like. No, regular oil goes bad and makes not fit for
it. I don't know about that. I'm going to have to read that because
it's all over here.
Well, I was told that that's absolutely not true. And that came from people who spoke to people in the Midwest that utilize the same type of system. And they do the same thing with suspend during the wintertime because they're extremely cold.
Okay.
But I'd be interested in seeing that.
Sure, absolutely. And as part of the Clean Fuel Initiative, is there also an initiative for the using propane?
That's one of the considerations.
Okay, is that part of the pilot program?
Not the pilot program. It was one of the other alternatives that we were looking at, and also as part of that was using hybrid versus retrofitting the vehicles that we had.
Okay.
So we haven't come to closure, but that was a consideration.
have you applied for the grant?
No, we have not.
No.
You'll speak to you?
Yes.
No, we have not.
Okay.
And there are reasons for that.
Okay, all right. Yeah, because there are some considerations for propane that are unique and are, don't seem to be very trivial from my account.
Yeah, I've had some issues with it as well, and I talked to the members of the council about it, so we're very likely.
I mean, we've actually had police car brought to us that was fitted with propane. We took it out for drives. They also promised, well, if we had gone through it, that they would put a propane tank down at the DPW and fence it while they had it all set, which we're, you know, we're concerned about. Now you have a 20,000 gallon propane tank sitting down there, you know, as a potential problem that it could be, which it's nice they're going to give it to us to use to put these cars, but there are certain things that we have to look at. I just wanted to.
We also have to meet state.
Right.
Why is all through all that?
But there are things, I just say tonight when we did transfer, one of the things that we had to do transfer, one was gasoline. We had to put $27,000 more into our gasoline tonight. We went to $27,000 more gasoline than we thought we were going to go this year because of the prices. And this is why we're looking at alternatives to save the taxpayers money. They're out there driving the DPW, cops, everything, you know, we're looking to save the taxpayers money, and we're looking at these programs and see if they work. And like you say, they're pilots. If they don't work down the road, we'll stop. But somewhere along the line, somebody has to take the stance and say, we're going to try this. And we're trying, we try to feel well. We've had the propane, we looked at it, and if we can save the taxpayers money, we're going to do it. And whether government says it's not good, it isn't good, whatever. If it's going to save the taxpayers' money in the long run, we're going to do it.
Well, actually, I'm in favor and I'm supporting this, but I think that the whole picture should be looked at. And one term I'd like to use is total cost of ownership. Yeah, the oil, the vegetable oil may be cheaper, but if DPW folks are being dedicated to spend time filtering it or doing extra labor to it, got to consider those labor costs too.
That's
total cost ownership. You may save money on oil, but if you're using more labor, well, that offsets and that kind of pricing.
Right. And we look at that. I mean, it just doesn't make sense that if you're saving a dollar a gallon and you're using that as labor, then you have a loss. So that's definitely something we're looking at. Just to get back onto the propane, the other thing that we're looking at is, and I've already talked to the department heads, regards to capitals for 2009, is that we're looking at green. And when I talk about that, and we're talking about green cars, hybrid cars, six-cylinder lease cars rather than, you know, the high-end, heavy eight-cylinder cars. And they've been kind of given the marching orders to look at some of these things in advance of coming in and looking at their capital improvements.
Yeah, I'm in favor of that too. Just that, just make sure that the reliability of the vehicles aren't impacted, because I don't want to be stuck, you know, having to be one stuck, you know, calling for the cops, and then the police car is going to break down.
Trust me, it won't happen.
Alright, and one last question I have is regarding the Alamo engineers for the field. Now, is the borough also looking for other quotes from other engineering companies for proposals?
Well, we didn't. They're not charging us anything to do it. All they did was come in and give us proposals.
Right.
Possibly cost.
Right.
I would venture to say that the mayor will probably have other specs to come in.
Okay. Yeah. Because usually when I get stuff at my fence, I call for folks to come in and give a quote. Now, even for the surveying that I've done on my property, I call the surveyor. So.
Yeah, once we get the specifications, we usually send it out via the post.
Okay. Appreciate it. Thank you, Paul.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, I have a question of you, please.
Yes,
I'm Councilman Cap.
Yes,
Councilman. What were the specific damages to the parts of the engine or the vehicle? What did it cost?
These are the parts that are the rubber parts, because the oil components, I think it's glycerin. I might have to check in the, it attacks those parts. It's not, now it doesn't, what it does is it attacks those parts and it causes leaks.
So the oil that's put in the engine through combustion attacks the rubber parts, that's all?
The raw fuel attacks those components.
The rubber parts of the engine?
Before it's combusted. And also, because the oil is generally thicker, now based on what I read from the document, it has a higher glycerin content. The glycerin causes a higher pressure to go through all the injector parts, so you're causing basically premature failure. Because those high pressure parts are not equipped to handle the higher pressures of the stiffer fuel.
So the injector parts and the rubber parts, that's the parts that damage?
Are impacted, according to that.
According to that?
Yes.
Thank you.
Now, again, I'm not an expert, I just go by what
I saw. I thought you were an engineer, because you said, Mr. Mann, I know you're not an engineer, I thought you were.
I'm an engineer, but I'm not licensed in the state, and I'm also not of this discipline. So.
Okay. So just what you got out of the book is what you're telling us. Okay. Thank you.
Anybody else in the public would like to come up and wait? Seeing and hearing nobody else, have a motion to close? So moved. Sandy? I, for one, would like to thank everybody for the year. Norman, you've been coming every meeting, and everybody else. I appreciate you coming to the meeting. Open government, at least to get to see what goes on. Anytime you want to come up here, and I wish you all a Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, Happy Holidays to everybody. Same to the veterans here, everybody. And that's it. Your motion?
Happy Holidays.
Happy Holidays.
So moved.
Second?
All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting is now.
Over.
Oh, my.
Why did you take my clothes?